What's up, everybody? Day 187, making Songbringer. I think it's 187. I lose count. Today I'm making the Ice Sword. The Ice Sword, man. So it's already working. Let's get it. Come on. Got him. You iced. Iced, baby. So there's a lot of things I want to do to keep this working better. Right now, I can sometimes an enemy will actually get its won't be able to. It'll run like an idle animation or something. Yo, what's up, Alex Beta? I just started. What's up, Brunsbear? So I'm working on the Ice Sword right now. Oh, it's day 188. Thanks, man. Sometimes I forget to change. We get that updated. What's up, Jonah19? Jonah19, are you from Southern California?
Sometimes I forget to change.
Hello! Not getting enough oomph out of your energy drink?
There we go. Thanks, Brunsbear. Okay, so yeah, I'm working on this Ice Sword today, and I think I'm gonna keep on finishing these swords, so that because these are so cool. I love the Ice Sword, the Ghost Sword, the Fire Sword's gonna be sweet too. The Fire Sword, you're gonna be able to like light things on fire. So see that guy right there, he got frozen, but his idle animation is still running. So I gotta fix that part. Oh, you're in the UK. Oh, yeah, sorry, I tried to actually start today at 2, but now it's 4, and I'm finally getting started. This happens almost every day. I'm like, I'm going to get started early today, and then it takes me 2 hours to really get ready to go. Oh, I was thinking your 1-9 was from, like, 619, like San Diego or something, but cool. That's awesome. UK. All right, I think I know what's going on with the, I think I have an idea of where it might be running a different animation. Where'd that go? Oh, here it is, animate the run. So yeah, if the entity is frozen, there's no need to do this at all. So I've already got a flag set up for freezing enemies and stuff. So dot flags and cave render frozen. So if we're not frozen, then we can update these animations. The marshmallow sword? There could be so many different kinds of swords, it's true. So how would you build that? You combine the ghost sword with a marshmallow and you get the marshmallow shard. What does that do? Makes all your enemies super delicious. This is kind of a bad area to be testing this on. But these guys right here are really good for testing this. Yeah, I think that worked. Cool. is this what you meant? Like they look like they're marshmallows? Oh, that might work. Yo, what's up, Felix? Cool. I think it's working now. It's just not changing the animation at all for these guys. It's great. Okay, cool. Well, I guess that was easy enough. Let's see. What happens when they're frozen and I hit them? It's like they get warmed up almost. Okay, I can fix that too. What's up, Sean is crazy? Nice. I think it's in health system. Animate? No, it's gotta be health system tick. Yeah, here's where it flashes its invincibility. Yeah, I think what we want to do here. Oh, sorry, man. Let's see if there's anything wrong on my end. Looks like everything's good. Sometimes I see some drop frames here. I'm not seeing that right now. So I'm going to go ahead and blame that on Twitch once again. Stupid Twitch. Okay, so I want to set the sprite for any entity that's still frozen back to additive after it's done flashing its invincibility. Close it and reopen? Oh, you know what it could be? It could be TwitchCon. There's like TwitchCon going on today. I bet you that has something to do with slowing down Twitch's servers and stuff. Okay, so it starts its invincibility. Saves its invincibility before. Hey, what's up, Loeb? Felix, you have an idea for a story, but no idea for mechanics. Is that bad? I would say no, not at all. You're always told mechanics come first. You know what? Screw that. Totally. I don't agree with that at all. It doesn't matter what comes first in a game, to me, at least. It doesn't matter at all. In fact, you're on the right track, I would say. It doesn't matter how you start or get into your game idea. It just matters that you did start. So now that you have a story idea, you are so close to having a game mechanic, you don't even know. All you got to do to generate ideas is to keep following your excitement about it. You're obviously excited about it enough to write a story for your game, right? You've got that story. That's a thread. All excitement is a thread that leads to more excitement. It doesn't even matter if what you're excited about is totally different than what you think you should be doing or what seems logically as the next step. And in fact, If you're giving in to your logic, if you're following your mind on things and you're logically trying to make decisions, I would say you're doing it wrong. Because what you should be doing is following your heart, your excitement, your emotions. Those kind of things are going to lead you to creativity. Logic kills your creativity. So if you ever find yourself in a situation where you're saying you think about things that people told you, that's where it's an instant sign that you're thinking with your head. And so I would say stop thinking with your head, think with your heart. You're already on the right track. Just give it time. Let it come to you and keep doing what excites you, and it will happen, man. What's up, Black Iron? Okay, I think this is what should happen. When it's done flashing its invincibility, so if the current health.invincible timer is less than zero, then we're gonna and the render.flags is frozen, then we're gonna force this back to additive. So let's see if that works. So I should be able to hit an enemy and then freeze an enemy, and then hit the enemy, and it will still be frozen colored after it's done. There we go. Yeah, man, I'm so excited to be making these swords, these different sword effects. This is a sweet item. Okay, that guy's frozen. Hit him. Oh, it didn't work. Okay, it's not working. Why is that? Oh, because it never ever gets below zero. Duh. Okay, so if it hits zero and we're frozen, then we want to reset back to additive. I should make this clear. All right, let's see if that worked. Yeah, sweet. Cool. He's still frozen. All right, cool. Next thing I want to do is make them so they flash when they're coming out of being frozen. They sort of thaw, right? So when they come to the end of their frozen time, they'll start to thaw out. All right. I think that's going to be when it actually sets the frozen. We can set up an action. Here we go. This is where ice freezes an enemy. So we've already got an action. Let's just put this back up here. This is where we pause the AI. This is where we unfreeze. It's going to be similar to this where we're unfreezing. It's going to start thawing out. I guess we could blink. We could just do a blink action with a delay. So it would be render.sprite.run action sequence create. Delay time, create. And we have what? The duration. So how long do we want it to thaw? Maybe a second. So this will be delay. So we'll do thaw duration. And then blink. Create. Thaw duration. And the number of blinks would be like thaw duration. Over 0.2, about. Let's see if that looks good. Okay, that's a good start. We could even progressively change its color, so it starts to being less and less blue. This is like not the optimal area to do this. Yeah, cool, that works. Yeah. Sweet. That looks okay. So I'm gonna try a little bit of something that thaws them out too. Is there a better way to do this? Stream's frozen? Dang, man. What's up, Doc? What up? Can you hear me? Can you see me? The stream might be frozen for some people here. It sucks. But there's TwitchCon going on today. I think that's what it might be. All right. Okay, so we got some people it's working, some people it's not. Dang. I think it's probably one of their servers or something that's going crazy. You got iced. You got iced, man. Dope. Right on, man. You started working on a platformer today? Cool. Oh, I love this art style, man. Yeah. No, this is sweet. I love this. So cool. Yeah, I could see you doing some parallax with that. That would look so rad. And I love how simple this is. I would play a game like this that had this simple of an art. It looks beautiful to me. Good job, Loeb. Yeah. Yeah, Sergeant Serg, that happens all the time. And it's sometimes just even on my end with Open Broadcaster. Like, Open Broadcaster is really not very good at syncing up my voice with my lips. So let's set the color. That's a tint to. Tint to create duration of 0. We want to, oh man, I have to do this individual red, green, blue. Anyways, this will start working. Hey, what's up, Zatrick? It's going great, man. Working on the ice sword today so far. Ah, cool. Right on. Dynamically changed colors. Sweet, man. I love it. So we'll get a thaw color. Here, this is the ice color. And I think I have a mix function which works with colors. I do. Beautiful. So I'm going to mix the ice color with white. And start with thaw color 1. It's thawed about, so let's say, a third. All right, so we're gonna tint to create thaw color 1 to R. This is such an annoying constructor. Thaw color dot G, thaw color dot B. So then we'll delay a little bit more. Actually, both these delays should be thaw duration over 3. No, let's multiply by a third, that's faster. All right, so this one's gonna be thaw color 2. This is just like, this will thaw the enemy, the color of it. Slowly. So three calls to that. Even though it's not very, I mean, I could write a function that would smoothly do that, but this is a little more simple. It's just code really fast. Oh, that was weird. That didn't work very well. Oh, because it probably runs after the blink. Okay. We need to do separate actions. So we need a first delay. The duration minus the thaw duration plus a third of the thaw duration. Hopefully this looks cool. So the next thing I want to do is add some particles coming off of the ice. So as the ice sword flies through the air, I want to see some particles falling off the end of it. Yeah, cool. That worked. It like slowly gets a little bit warmer. Cool. That's what I wanted to see. Sweet. Devil Robot, what's up, man? You're talking about pros, cons of procedurally generated levels. What are your thoughts on procedurally generated levels with some custom planned areas? Would that negatively affect replayability? Or what other considerations do you have to take into account? I don't think so. This game has an area that's always there and never changes. That's your ship. So whenever you fly, when you go back to your ship, it's not even going to be procedurally generated. I don't know. I guess it totally depends on your game, but I think as long as you have some area that's like really cool and is procedurally generated, then that's all you really need. Yeah, the only thing I was trying to say the other day about procedurally generated games is that you got to make sure you're taking a lot of time to generate an entire world worth of awesome stuff that you can put into your procedurally generated world, so it doesn't feel like it's created by a computer. And you also got to spend a lot of time on your maze algorithms or whatever algorithms you're using to generate your world. Just spend a lot of time on that, and it'll get to the point where it feels like it's a bespoke world. Sorry, I don't have very concrete thoughts there on that one yet. Are the MacBook Pros worth it? I believe they are. If you're a game developer, it's one of your most important tools is your computer. So I think it's worth every cent, personally. Yeah, I could have used Spawn there, Jonah19, but that would have been more complex. I like seeing this more simple, with one single action dedicated to the sequence and another one dedicated to this. If I had used a spawn, it would have indented things and created more complexity, and it would have been difficult to go and change it later. That's the whole reason why I did that like that. Yeah. Oh, dry ice smoke? Now that's a rad idea too. Yeah, let's do that. Okay. So we'll do some smoke particles. I like that. And then we'll also do some ice coming off of the ice sword when it flies through the air. So I can do that right here in this function. Man, this is one of the longest functions in my whole game so far, is the change hit points. I've really got to improve this, break this down into smaller functions. Like, this whole freezing thing is already its own function. I should put that in. I should do that right now. Yeah, let's do that right now. So, system. This will be the collision system. No, this should be the health system, actually. So we're going to freeze an entity. Here's the entity. Here's the one that changes them. I think that's all we need for this. Yeah, Devil Robot. These are two really different ways of doing it. This way is a lot more simpler if you're going to use pre-built blocks and then fit them together randomly. And that's kind of a cool way to do it, actually, because you're blending procedurally generated with bespoke. This is how Binding of Isaac does it. They draw, they create all these different levels and they randomly arrange them. Songbringer is a little different in that it actually procedurally generates the entire world on a tile level. So it's a lot of it has to be done in code. The advantage of doing it with pre-built blocks is it's a lot easier to code. The procedurally generated with tiles is a lot harder to code because you got to come up with algorithms for every one of your patterns and stuff. I know, yeah. It is, Zatrick has it, it's money. Yeah, it's totally not just Binding of Isaac, but lots of games do it that way. Yeah, that's true. Yeah, you can use different sized rooms. All right, so I'm going to put all this in the freeze function. So if we're already frozen, we can just return from this method. I love it. Okay, so then we need an eid here. Okay, so to do some... Let's do some particles coming off of... First, let's make sure this still works. Didn't break anything with that little change there. Okay, so I broke it. Oh, I think I know I broke it. I just didn't call it. Wow, I didn't know there were so many ways to do procedural generation. What's a grid-based dungeon generator? There's so many ways to do it. So many. This is cool. I want to check this out later. This is a great link to share too. Xbox Taco. A drum set fell off a cliff. Sup, Grim Gary? Okay, let's see if that worked now. Sweet, cool. They still thaw. It looks great. I think I want this thing to return. I'll do that later. So I was thinking about adding weakness, resistance, immunity, but that's a task for the next moment. I want to do these cool effects particles first. So thaw out, unfreeze. Unfreeze is a little more important, so I'm going to put that above. Thaw out. This is where we'll do some particles. Yeah, I'm doing great. So great. I love what I do. I love what I do. It's so exciting every day to keep making this game. So awesome to see the progress, you know? Look back. Look forward. Look around. So this will be Steam. Hey, what's up, Hyrule Spy? I'm good, man. Just great. Making the ice sword today. I'm working on some steam now. So I did a thawing out effect. Now I'm working on some steam that'll come off of enemies when they thaw. So let's do a number of particles, like maybe 10. Let's loop over that. Yeah, well, probably not all of them together. So all of the swords work already, but they're not all of their effects are not actually done. So I'm working on the ice sword today, and that'll be finished. I'll have that done, so you guys will be able to see that for sure. The ghost sword already works. The fear sword already works, but the fire sword and the lightning swords, both of those are gonna take a day probably each. So the fire sword is gonna be super cool, where you can shoot out fireballs, basically, and they can light things on fire. So other enemies get lit on fire. Bales of straw, like things that could get easily lit on fire, will get lit on fire. And the lightning is also, I'm not exactly sure how that one will work. But so these will take some time. So not quite. Hello, Sunset Kite. What's up, man? Okay, so I want to create a new sprite for each one of these. I think I have this sprite called Circle Gradient, which would work well for some steam. This is not a pixel. The position, let's get a pause to start with. A harmonic sword? A stunning sword. That's a cool one. I think this would be the guitar. So you're going to have a guitar. That would be a cool thing to do, right? To be able to, like, you play a note on your guitar and enemies are harmonized for a moment. I like it. The guitar is also going to be used for opening up secrets and stuff like that. So it could be a multi-used kind of item. No, that's not divided by pixel. That's fine. Pause. We want to go pause plus back to drand f times 10.0. Thanks for following. And we'll do drandf. Yeah. Oh, this is supposed to be drandf. And then we also want to add in a little bit to, like, I don't know, maybe tile height or 12, maybe 15, 14. Oh, it all depends on the size of the sprite. So e.render.sprite.getContent. That's not going to work. Let's just start with 8. Squirrel power. Any point in learning C? Or am I just confusing myself for C++? What do you guys think? I'm mainly learning coding because my teacher recommended it. I'll keep noob questions to a minimum. No worries, man. Feel free to ask noob questions anytime. I'm very happy to answer them. And yes, I think it's incredibly important to learn C. I would first learn C before you learn C++. I highly recommend learning C before you ever learn C++. Definitely. Sunset Kite. You talking about the website for Songbringer? Yes, I did. Oh, and I also want this to be a vec2. So we'll go vec2 pause. Then we can easily add to the y. And then we can easily also combine this with that random factor. Anchor point. This is going to be 0.5, 0.5. So put it right in the middle. Its parent is going to be area layer. Z, this is going to be on top of everything, so we'll put it up way up high at like 2000. Okay, now we should run an action, so sprite.runAction. Any good tutorials on C#? I don't know. I think Learn Code the Hard Way might have one. Nope, it doesn't. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know C# myself. I know it's really similar to the languages that I'm familiar with, but I just have never learned it. So we want to have this thing rise into the air and then also fade out. So we'll start with the fade. The fade is going to be a sequence. Let's get a duration. Oh, we already got a duration. We'll do steam duration. 1, 1002, 1003, 1004. Yeah, about 3.5 seconds. Okay, fade out for the steam duration. And I want it to go like this too as it moves upward. So that I think I need to do a Bezier action or something like that. Fade out? Shouldn't need another. Now we're gonna do remove self after we've done the fade. Cool, got that yet. Cool, right on, man. Yeah, I don't know any tutorials on C#, but I would recommend doing tutorials on Unity. And usually as you do those tutorials with Unity or whatever, you're gonna get to know some C# as you go. Well, I mean, do you already know C or other languages? Anyway, either way you go, if you do some tutorials on Unity, I think it'll help you learn some C# in the process. Yeah, Elite SCV. I guess it doesn't matter. It doesn't. If you find it useful, it doesn't matter what other people say. Okay, cool. Well, if you That's great because you already know a language. That's awesome. And in fact, Python is an incredibly good one to start with because it's very C-like in ways. So, and it's syntax. Okay, so I wanted to move upward and do a Bezier. Bezier by, I've never done a Bezier before. We've got steam duration. So const cc bezier config. Let's see how to configure one of these. Oh, okay, that's not even that hard. We got an end position, a control point one, and a control point two. No worries, that's easy. Nice. Cool. That's good that you know that your scope was too big at first, because that's a great thing to realize as soon as you can. So yeah. Whoa. All right, so the end position, we want to start wherever we are and end up about 10 pixels above. And we want to do c.control.1 set. This is where we want to go to the left. I think we want to do 0 on y. I'm not sure, though. I've never done one of these actions before. So let's try it like this. And then we'll just run this action once. We might want to exaggerate this action a lot, actually. We can put this definition outside of the loop. Okay, so we're running a Bezier. That should move it up a little bit. And I can repeat that action a few times so it keeps on moving up. It's already fading out and deleting itself. So it should be good. Oh, I also want to set a scale. That's really important. Sprite, I'd set scale. This needs to be way smaller than it is. I got a really big gradient circle thing. Hey, what's up, Mr. Widmer? Nice. Ah. Yeah, IntelliSense is definitely really helpful. You get to know. It's so helpful, right? When I started coding, it was in MS-DOS Edit. That's funny. So it launched all these right away. We want this to happen right at the very end once it's done thawing. So, we'll schedule a function once. We want the EID. Has to take a float as an argument. The delay is just the overall duration. No, duration minus thaw duration. The key is steam. So now I also want these to fade in. I agree, Brunsbear. Hey, what's up, Nano? Yeah, happy Friday to you too, man. Yeah, I know this sounds like I have my dream job and it's all easy and stuff for me to get here, but really it took a lot of courage for me to actually get to this point with this video game. I started this whole project with absolutely no income. It took me 4 months to even get to the point where I had the Kickstarter to be able to get to keep doing this. I had no guarantees that the Kickstarter would succeed either. Every single month I was scraping by, barely making any income. I was scraping by doing web work and living off of savings and things like that. I was like barely making it on a monthly basis. So when the Kickstarter succeeded, it was like such a weight lifted off my shoulders. So it's difficult. It's difficult to follow your dreams and do what you really, really want to do. But it is worth it. You know what I mean? And I do feel that the universe has way more ability to support us and what we really want to do than we think. And it just takes that initial courage to get over those things. So, but sometimes you're in the place where it's not the right time for you to make that move. So you got to do it. You got to do it with your own heart and you got to follow what you're doing and just do it in your own time. You know, it'll happen. Right. Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, thanks. Thank you. Yeah. These guys were, seriously. Everybody understood. Today I had an interface named eye tracking selection delegate. That's great. Okay, I want this to fade in. So, let's start that. Oh, well, we can just do fade in dot create steam duration. Let's say we'll fade in for a second. Oh, no, we'll fade in for 1 second and then fade out for the duration. So we'll start with 0 opacity. No, actually we'll start with 1 opacity. Yeah, exactly, right? The timing will come. And all I'm saying, Zatrick, is when that time comes, I'm rooting for you. You know what I mean? When that time comes for you, and you don't have to do it the hard way. Like the way I got myself into a really bad financial situation before I started this, I would not recommend that. So if you have a job right now and you're kicking ass at it and you're making money, that's great. I would definitely recommend saving up money while you're doing that so that you can do your dreams at some point, you know, and just make it easy on yourself. There's no need to make it hard. I definitely wouldn't recommend that. What's up, Arcane? Okay, so that was working good with this whole Bezier thing. Let's do a repeat. Repeat create. Bezier create. And we'll repeat it 3 times. And then we'll divide this by 3. It's duration. Okay, let's see how that looks. So, one more thing. I only want it to fade to, like, at most 128 opacity. Nice, right on. 5 years till you're gonna be debt-free. That's great. Make games the hard way. There should be one of those websites. Make games the hard way. Get yourself in tons of debt. Have absolutely zero income for over a year. Make a game that fails. There's like so many ways to make it hard on yourself. Okay. That looked weird. Let's start by making those a little, yeah, a little less opacity. Let's start there. Maybe 80. A little tighter. So, random positions. Oh, it would be also really nice to do. Control point one. This should be randomized a little bit. Coding binary. Cool. All right, we got that. So let's do this too. We'll go float xdist equals drand f times 4.0, and then we'll add 4.0 to it and give it like a if drand f01 is less than 0.5, then we'll go xdist times equals negative 1, or just equals negative xdist. And this is going to be xdist, and this is negative xdist. So that'll give some randomization to how the actual particles move. As they say, every bit counts. I love this. What's up, XPixel? XKCD. Nano, real programmers use Emacs or Vim. Oh, hey, real programmers use Vim. This is great. Can you imagine using Cat? You real programmers use a magnetized needle and a steady hand. There's an Emacs command to do that. Oh man, you gotta love XKCD. This is probably one of my favorite ones I've ever seen. Dude, I gotta save this link. This is my favorite XKCD I've ever seen. So good, so good. What's up, Dekarki? Okay, let's see if that worked better this time. Look more like Steam. Actually, it should probably be more transparent. Yeah, and it needs to be higher. More transparent, higher. So let's go. At least 16. I wish I knew the exact height, the exact pixel height. Oh, you know what? Maybe I can know the exact pixel height. I'm gonna check this out. Let's start with 16 there, but let's go. F equals E dot render dot sprite dot get content. No, not content. Get frame. No. Get sprite frame. Get. I thought there was a get. get Sprite, get wrecked. There's some, get, there's this, there's get wrecked, but I'm pretty sure there's a Sprite method to get the wrecked. Dot height. Okay. Oh, this is dot size dot height. Nice. I didn't notice that. Oh. Yeah, Jonah19, it is get content size, but that's the wrong one. That's the one I don't want to use, because get content size actually returns the area of the sprite with any empty pixels around it. Oh yeah, I've heard a lot about Wanderlust Adventures. This is, yeah, totally. I gotta add, it's already on my wish list. Why am I in German all of a sudden? Oh, probably because you sent me a German link. Yeah. Yeah, okay, I already got this on my wish list. Totally. This looks like a great game. Totally. Leth? Yeah, Leth did a lot of the work on that. I'm sure there's a command to find the disc. Hello, Ben Hexer. Welcome to the stream, man. So yeah, what I was saying there about the difference between the sprite frame rect and the content size is I think the sprite frame rect does not include empty pixels. I'm going to check that out just by setting a breakpoint here before I call this. So I'm pretty sure, let's illustrate the differences. So I'll just get the rect and I'll get the content size. And we can see the difference. All right, Outrule Spy, good night, man. Yeah, everything's going great, Ben Hexer, man. Yeah, Risk of Rain, totally. I'm pretty sure I got that one on my wish list, too. I got a lot of games on wish list lately. All right, so here it is. We've set a breakpoint in here. Whoop. Let me just get this off my to-do list. Oh, here we go. Add that to my wish list. Rain of Depth. No. Okay, so we got the R and the S. R size is 12 by 28. See, this is the difference I was talking about right here. Jonah. Yeah, so see, this content size includes the empty pixels, so I get a content size of 30 by 30, but what I wanted was the actual pixel size of the entity. So this guy has an actual pixel height of 28 and an actual pixel width of 12. And the reason it does not include that is because I'm using Texture Packer, and Texture Packer takes out any empty pixels around. Even if I export a PNG file with empty pixels in it, what happens is Texture Packer packs it smaller with all those empty pixels removed. And then when Cocos 2DX loads that sprite, it adds back in the empty space into the content size. So this is a good way of going. So I can use the get rect right here to add to the height. So I'm gonna go pause.y. Whoa, trying to give you some Objective-C code there. Plus equals the get rect dot size dot height. times like 80% or whatever. That'll make the steam look like it's coming off of the top of the sprite here. Hey, what's up, PMC? Yeah, I hope this helps, man. Yeah, it's a, you know, this is the kind of thing that I keep talking about when you're talking about getting familiar with an engine. This is the kind of stuff that takes 3 to 6 months almost sometimes. Just you got to get familiar with an engine enough so you can do little things like that. Like if I was not familiar with this engine, that little task right there would have taken half a day possibly. Yeah, cool. That looked good. I want the steam duration a little shorter. I want the opacity even lower. Let's even set the max opacity in a constant. So let's get it down to like 32. Let's do 31. Max opacity. Now, how long is it waiting? Duration minus thaw duration. That's okay. Let's try that again with that less. Oh, another great thing to do would be to vary its scale. So let's do a scale starting at 0.05 plus 0.1 times DRAND F01. Cool. Yeah, I'm glad. I'm so excited for all such rad indie games that are coming out. Actually, the one I'm really, really looking forward to playing is Axiom Verge. I can't wait to play Axiom Verge. Just need some free time. Okay, why does it... It's not quite that smooth. I wonder if I do end position dot y. Oh, c dot end position dot y times like a third. I think I'm wondering if the Bezier has to be this way to get a smoother Bezier. Cool. Yeah, Leth makes some of that game live too. I don't know if you guys have heard of Leth, but he's another awesome live streamer guy. Yeah, no, that's getting a lot better. I'm thinking even less opacity though. Do 22. Okay, cool. This is almost ready to do some particles coming off of the back of the ice sword flying through the air. Little bastard. Love it. This is getting better. Another thing I can do is vary the lifetime or the height. Actually, the height would be a good thing to lower a bit. Actually, did that work? I think that did work with the end position. Let's vary this height a little less. The steam wouldn't rise that much, you know? Oh, boo. Dang, that sucks. Well, that's cool. At least they made a rad game, you know? Windows is the most popular platform for playing games out there. So... yeah, that's looking good. Actually, I think I want him to fade in a little bit faster too, and be a little less. I think I'm like 707 there, and then fade in a little faster. Yeah, Zatrick, it's coming out on Retro VGS, man. The dopest console ever. And if I get enough funds, I'll also do PlayStation 4 and Xbox One. So, but I'm really, really excited about this one the most, personally. Retro VGS. And also iOS. Definitely coming out on iOS, even though you can't really consider that a console, really, but. But it is a total, it's a different platform. Yeah, I want it to fade in faster, even faster than that. Maybe 0.3. Nice. Oh, that's right, Zatrick. Yeah, I think they're going to be reasonably priced too. And what's really dope about the Retro VGS is if you own a Retro VGS, that's all you need to develop on it. So all you need to develop is a USB cord that connects your computer to a Retro VGS, and that's it. So compare that to a PlayStation developer kit, which is like, I think it's like $1,000 or something crazy. Yeah, and I would argue a little less height even. Height, where's that? Oh, here. What's up, It Suds? Yeah, man, I do everything. I even do the business. This is a totally solo project, but in essence, it's not entirely a solo project. I have you guys to bounce ideas off of and also give me ideas and give me feedback and stuff. It's freaking awesome. I highly recommend making a game live like this. Cool. Okay, that I just spent a long time doing that Steam, but I think it looks pretty good now. So let's move on to the next thing, and that's to add some particles that are flying off the back of the sword when it's flying through the air. That's right, it's Wiz plus community. And just to prove that, what program I'm using? Photoshop. I use Photoshop for my art, and I use Ableton for music. So what I was saying is just to show you all the backers for this game, that everybody's thanked here on the main menu. So this is what'll happen. You'll see this on every copy of Songbringer. Every single person that ever backed this game or pre-ordered it. So if you want to get your name on the game right now, all you got to do is pre-order the game. It's only cost $16, and that all contributes to. You like this pitch? I'm pitching right now. I'm pitching the game. $16. Give me your money. Anyways, people's names that are in gold are the ones that backed at higher levels. These are people that backed the Kickstarter. And once again, I'm so thankful for all these people. Some of these names I haven't even seen yet. Joe Saint. Thank you, Joe Saint. Gilby? That must have been Brad. Matt Albrecht. Thank you, everyone. I know, totally. Oh, right. Nope. You don't get a share in the profits. Sorry about that. When's it coming out? It's a... somewhere between January and March, so about 5 months from now. Wow, yeah, it's $2,500 for a PS dev kit. Yeah, I knew it was I thought it was $1,000, but yeah, $2,500. That means you have to be a big dog, right? You can profit by playing it. You know what? I might actually. You know, there's on Steam, you can actually get you can release your own mods for a game. So I might actually make it so you can. I've had plans for the whole time of Song where you're making it really a hackable game. So, but maybe I'll make it so you can mod it too. So then you can sell your own mod on Steam, and then you could actually profit from it. So, monetarily, I mean. So, okay, let's get this. So we gotta, I want some particles to fly off the sword. Okay, we'll do it in the launch. Oh, of course. Yes, of course, Zatrick. Speedrunning community is so important to me because I love speedruns of Zelda. So I already have a timer in the game. So when you go to your menu, all the text is missing from the menu right now because I need to localize it. But there's usually the word time here in the bottom right. And so my time for this game is 7:09. So there's a built-in timer right there. And when you finish the game, it'll show you how fast you completed. And your score on the leaderboard is based on how fast you completed it. So a lot of this game goes into how fast you complete it. So because it's procedurally generated, so I think it's a really interesting thing to see how fast you can speedrun the same level, you know. You don't know C++ teach you. All right, man, just pay attention. You'll learn. Release the idea text. If there's ideas on the list that aren't done by the end, I'll do that for sure. Okay, right. When it launches the Ghost Sword, we can do some particles right then. Okay, so here's where it creates the ice sword. So I'm gonna add some actions which give it some particles. So ice particles. So we'll do, once again, we'll do a number of particles. This depends on the duration. Duration is lifetime and all that. Duration, we got the duration here. Let's do duration over, let's say every 0.1 seconds, we're gonna get a particle. Oh, that's right, I forgot I had a chapter about C++. Yeah, totally. It's here, it's C++ refresher. I totally forgot about this. Yeah, this is kind of an introduction, right? It talks about headers and source files, writing comments, declaring variables, talking about the difference between C and C++, writing decoupled code, readability, using this. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Zatrick. I forgot all about this. Right on. You're chilling in the Baltic Sea? Cool. Are you going to that festival? Isn't there a big festival in the Baltic Sea? So I'm kind of doing the same exact thing I just did for this, the steam particles. Just creating a sprite. This one's going to be based on pixel. I just have a single pixel inside of a file. So we want the exact same position as the current entity. So for every one of these, we need a delay timer. So this is a lambda inside a lambda right here. Oh, thank you, Zatrick. Yeah, that's a great one too. This one, I want to turn this into an entire book. So I got a Kickstarter post I'm working on, actually how I did the Kickstarter and stuff like that. I got to finish this. It's like, it's getting, it's like, I kind of had the goal to do it last week, but I worked on Rapid Game a little bit instead. But yeah, I got this post already started for how to do a Kickstarter. So I got to finish this up and get that up there. But I'm basically creating a book on how to be creative, how to get your creations out there, how to do creative projects and stuff like that. Oh, really? Okay. Cool. Lambception, totally. Nice one, dude. Nice joke, dude. I hope other people got this. That's so great. What's up, Cottage? When you go to make something like this in Xcode, what type of application do you choose to start from? Like, the only one I could find that uses C++ is the command line tool application? What do you mean? Do you mean to start developing from, or just run the game? If you're talking about running the game, it's right here in Xcode. You just run. You click the play button. Yeah, what you mean here? I'd love to help you out to answer this question better. Oh, sweet. Oh, cool. I'll watch this one tonight. This is great. Thank you, PMC. I really need to watch some stuff about the speedrunning community. Sweet. Because I definitely support speedrunners. I need a t-shirt that says that. Hey, what's up, Zelda Rock. It's going great, man. Oh, you mean to create a new project? Oh, you are. Yeah, okay, I get it now, Cottage. Yeah, I would just go file new project, right? And then, yeah, command line tool is one way you could do it. This game one, I probably wouldn't even use this. I would actually just use command line tool myself. Or, you know, I've got Cocos 2DX, so I could just do a start a new Cocos 2DX project. And this is like you just run a script and that gives you the ability to create Cocos 2DX projects. I think this would be the way I would start because this is the engine I use. But if I weren't using an engine, I would just start with the command line tool because it's, then you can work in however the heck you're going to do your game. So, yeah, command line tool is probably the way to do it. Oh, no worries, man. I hope that helps the answer there. Nice. You're a speedrunner? Sweet. This game is meant for you. What's up, baby? Streaming. Yeah. Ooh, that's my girl. All right, nice. Oh, I'm so stoked, babe. I love you. Okay, cool. See ya. Yeah, my girl just got a new job. She got a promotion. She's been angling for this promotion for months, and it just all happened. So rad. In Hero Bash, are you matching with people based on your trophies? No, you're not. But in Hero Bash, you do get more trophies if your trophies are less than another person. So if you have basically more rep as from your trophies, you're gonna get. Or if you have less than another person, you're going to get more trophies if you beat them, and you're going to get less trophies if you lose to them. So it kind of balances things out based on how many trophies you have. Yes, definitely. Nice, man. Yeah, you're like, oh, but I don't know what happened. Yeah, totally. I'll tell her, you guys. I'll definitely tell her that. So, let's show you the game a little bit. before I do these ice particles, I'll show Zelda Rock, you're totally new here. Let me show you the game a little bit so you can get a feel for what this is. It's like Zelda 1, but it's procedurally generated. That's the big difference. So this entire, when you start a game with this, when you start an adventure, you enter 6 letters, and those 6 letters generate an entire world based on those 6 letters. So your whole world is procedurally generated all the way down to the tile level. So this is not like Binding of Isaac where you create a world or whatever, and it's all randomly just arranged. It's actually procedurally generated, not randomly arranged. So you're this guy here, Rock with the sword. You got a robot friend there that scans the bodies of enemies when they die. So if I can kill one of these guys. These new burrowing enemies are kind of tricky to beat. But anyways, so you get the point, right? It's kind of like Zelda 1. You got lots of cool items. This is the teleport item. Let's get to a level. Where's the level at? See if we can find a level. Oh, there's these new enemies. What you're seeing right now is the ice sword I'm working on. So you you can craft items. So check this out. You got a teleport cube. You can't use your teleport cube when there's enemies on the screen. So there. Your teleport cube takes you back to your ship. Your spaceship is here in the atmosphere. So you warp back to your ship. And you got this dude you can go and craft items with. So that's also a big difference from Zelda. So you can let's say you want to craft your sword with something else. I don't have any items I can actually craft right now, but this is where you would craft your items and stuff. So let me warp you. I'll warp you to the actual dungeon so you can see those too. Yeah. Yeah, I know the robot mustache is an item, so you can. I've got that in my save game right now. That's the jib stash. So you got the jib stash. Let's put the player at 111 and see if that's. I hope that's part of the level. All right, cool. So yeah, this is kind of what dungeons look like. It's very speedrunner friendly. So I was just saying that it tracks your time in the bottom right, based on how long you've been in the game and stuff. Oh, the ice effect looks really weird on these guys because they're so dark. That's one thing to note. Oh, that guy's still alive. Nice. Got the cyan password. Oh, and another thing that's different between this and Zelda is that you've got these things called cactuses. And when you eat a cactus, you get to reveal secret walls. So if there were any secret walls on this level, the cactus that I just ate would show that to me. So it looks like there's no secrets in this room. Oh, the top hat! Yeah, top hat's a great item. So the top hat, you get to throw your top hat. It's another projectile-like weapon. So that's kind of an intro to the game. Call it Songbringer. Yeah. No, she is going to be Mrs. Wiz. Yeah, we got engaged this summer. Yep. So we got engaged last month. We took this vacation and I proposed to her next to a waterfall. So yep, it's the future Mrs. Wiz. Nice, right on. Thanks, Patrick. Thank you. Yeah, cheers. Cheers. It's pretty awesome. It's kind of crazy to be getting to that point in life where I'm like, I'm ready to get married. I still feel like a kid inside. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I haven't told anybody. So you guys I've told my friends and stuff, but I haven't told anybody on the live stream at all. So you guys are the first to know. So we wanted to come right. Oh yeah, we want to do all of this ice particles inside a lambda within a lambda. So shot.render.scheduleOnce. Oh, sprite.scheduleOnce. PMC, I just told everybody right here on the stream that I got engaged, so my girl and I are engaged. Yes. Yes, yes, it is about time. Definitely. I'm a lucky man. We've been together 5 years, so we should be married by now, you know, or we should be at least be engaged by now. Thank you, Professional Novice. Much appreciated. So we need the entity ID again. That's like the shot ID. Yeah, cheers. What's up, a clone geek? Yo. Okay, so I'm just creating I'm creating some sprites inside this lambda within a lambda to create. So really what I should, this is an automatic cue that this really should be in another function, right? Once you're creating a lambda within a lambda, you probably should put that in a smaller function. But anyways, I'm just gonna code it right here inside this function for now. Thank you. Cheers, IDK Smash. Do I ever get that I look like Pauly Shore? No, I've never gotten that one before. That's hilarious to me. Pauly Shore? I guess so, right? Pauly Shore, that's great. Definitely a first. Ouch. I don't think it's an ouch. Pauly Shore, he was in what are some fun, like, famous movies he was in? He's in you guys would know. Somebody out there knows. In the army now? Yeah. Yeah. Giorgio Tsuk. Which guy's that? Encino Man, of course. He is. Nano's 12 years old. Isn't that cool? I don't know who this guy is. Oh, this guy from the aliens? I watched this whole series with this guy with all the ancient alien theories. I think it's a really cool theory. Definitely inspired me. It better come with a manual like Zelda 1. Done. But it's gonna be a PDF. Right on. Hey, what's up? Hey, Noah, Net. Yeah. That guy's great. Could it be ancient aliens? Okay, so each one of these is a delay of I times like 0.1. So we're going to get one of these every tenth of a second. So actually, let's put that into a constant. Const float delay per equals 0.1. So we can go delay per right there, and then delay per right here. And then this key. Oh, this key is going to need to be different for each one of these. So, okay, we'll just do a kit string with format. So this is ice particle. Percent D I there. Yeah, sorry, man. How do you say it? What Songbringer about? Aliens. It totally is. Have you guys seen that? That's a really, really great series to watch. Ancient Aliens. I think a lot of it's plausible myself. So I want all these ice particles to be additive lighting. It's like a nice little thing to make them. Additive. Okay, no, color too. We want to capture that and set the sprite's color. And then, okay, we want to do a fade out and if falling to the ground. Oh, A.E. Noah. A.E. Noah. Okay, got it. Are there any images of Songbringer work in progress? There's like a billion. Yeah, you're going to see me making it right here. But, yeah, if you want to look at actual images, just go to my Twitter. Twitter Wizard Foo. There's like tons of images and tons of like, GIFs and everything. Why is it Foo? Yeah, it's from way before Entity Foo. It's like Kung Fu, but Wizard Foo. It's like Kung Fu, but for computer geeks like me. Yes, good. Right on. So cool, Professional Novice. I love hearing that. Go, man. Go for a drink. Fortune's algorithm. What the heck is that? Thanks, Aline. It's a sweep line algorithm for generating a Voronoi diagram. Okay. Ooh. This is cool. It's like creates cells almost. Sweet algorithm. Yes. Yes. Okay, one more thing. We got sprite. Sprite.runAction. I should have just copied all the code for the Steam, because it's almost the same thing. Create. We got a fade out. Create. How long does each one take? Oh, let's do a life. I'm thinking about a second for them to fall to the ground. Oh. Oh, alien. Oh, I got you now. Oh. That's crazy. I was calling you Aline. Alien. Got it. I got it now. Alien. You're trying to do a map generator. Whoa. Dude, this is rad. What a cool way to do it. So using a graph structure made of polygons. Yeah, dude, this is rad. We were just talking about procedurally generated algorithms a second ago. This is a rad one right here. Yeah, this is where you do the graph structure part right there. You could even make it. You could even make it lock certain areas behind parts of those. I'm sure. Dude, so cool. This is some advanced awesomeness right here. Ooh, look at that. It even has rivers. Moisture. Biomes. Dude, this is one of the best procedural algorithms I've ever seen. This is kind of like what I'm striving to create with this game. Look at that. This is an actual rendering, dude. Wow. So, man, this is blowing me away. I gotta take a look at this in more detail later on. Look how many things I'm piled on my desktop already today. Hey, what's up, Lith? Oh, yeah, I've seen No Man's Sky, but I haven't seen how they do their procedural.
I mean, this is kind of like...
Really? Oh, cool. Dude, I got a lot of stuff to check out tonight. Behind the scenes, No Man Tech. Yeah, No Man's Sky, dude, this is a rad-looking game, for sure. This is one that I'm excited about that's 3D. I'm not always excited about 3D games, but this one for sure. What's that? The fourth dimension? Yes, I do love stuff like this. In fact, I got one to share with you guys. If you guys haven't seen this. Yo, Momir, what's up, Momir? Chat assigns you homework. No, I got some homework for you guys. Michio Kaku. The March towards a Type 1 civilization. No, not this one. Maybe it's this one. No, this is not it. The physics of extraterrestrial civilizations. Here you go. This is kind of it. I wanted to give you guys the YouTube video, but if you haven't seen Michio Kaku talking about going from a type, I think maybe it was called going from. Right, yeah. Yes, definitely. Maybe it's this one. Oh, yeah, this is his introduction to...
Space for alien life. We don't look for little green men. We look for type 1, type 2, and type...
This is kind of it. Anyways, he talks about the different civilization types. Type 0 being what we're at. Type 1 being a civilization that can control all of the energy output of their own planet. Type 2 being you can control the energy output of your star. And then type 3 being you can control the energy output of your entire galaxy. Pretty rad. But it's all based on this Kardashev scale that the dude made in like 1930 or something. Okay. So yeah, we're gonna fade out for the delay, the lifetime of this particle, and then remove it. Okay, and then we also, I want it to move downward with a nice smooth action. So sprite.run action, ease, exponential, out. This is going to make it really smooth. Move by, create, a duration of the lifetime of the particle, delta position, vec2, about the height, which is 0, negative 8 or so, times kit pixel. Okay, we're ready to try this out finally. Yeah. Definitely. Definitely. Yeah, I'd love to see that. I'm probably going to love this app. Thank you, Nano. I love that kind of stuff for sure. I would love to see an app that tries to visualize an atom, because I know that what we think of as an atom is so wrong. Or at least if you think of the 1950s version of an atom, it's just completely wrong. Alien, yeah, this is for multiple platforms. This is coming out on Steam first for Windows, Mac, and Linux. That's going to be like January to March, somewhere in there. And then it's also coming out for iOS and maybe Android. But it's definitely coming out for Retro VGS, a new console is coming out soon. And if I can get the funds or if the game does well on Steam, I'll also release it on PlayStation 4 and Xbox One. Wait, did it work? Oh yeah, it does. It did work. Cool. That's kind of cool to see some particles like that. I want to see way more of them though. And I guess I want them to ease in. So ease in. Let's move this onto its own line. Yeah. Okay, so ease in and more of them. I want to see like a delay per of like 0.05 to start with. Yeah. Yeah, totally. It worked on the first try. Sweet. Thanks, Alien. That's awesome, man. Yeah, if you want, you can pre-order on songbringer.com. And if you pre-order, you get your name in the credits and also on the main menu of the game. So on the main menu of the game, I was just showing that a second ago, people's names get listed. Okay, so sorry, what I was trying to say there is on the main menu of the game, it shows everyone that's a backer or an honorary backer of the game. So whenever you pre-order the game, you become an honorary backer. What the heck happened there? That was super weird. Oh, it looks like I might have killed an enemy right, or frozen an enemy right before they died. Oh, it's okay. It needs to have some more height. Definitely needs some spread. Definitely. And it needs to have the height of the actual ghost sword. So let's look at the ghost sword and see how many pixels high it is. Looks like we want that to be at least 14 pixels up. All right. So let's get a const height. Capture that variable, and then the sprite position is going to add vec2 0 height, and then it moves negative height, and let's do some random jitter to make them a little more just a slight randomness to this. Drand f times 0.01. Well, that's gonna be really, really slight, but we'll see. You had to write an opinion-based essay. Yeah, cool. That's a cool opinion, man. I like that. Coding should be a normal school subject. I agree. And they have some sweet apps and like things that make coding really simple today. Nice. Right on. Thanks, PMC. Yeah, Alien, I'm using Cocos 2DX to start with. So that's a huge thing. It's the game engine I use, and it does a lot of work for me. This is a really, really great open source C++ cross-platform game engine, and it literally does. There's so much stuff I like. Like for example, this all these actions and stuff I'm doing are all Cocos 2DX. I'm just the one calling all these actions, but they wrote all the code to implement all that. They wrote all the code to do sprites, render, reload sprite sheets, get all the stuff ready for every one of the platforms that you do. It's almost already ready to go, like your startup code for stuff. Yeah. Sweet. Thank you, Lith. Nice. That's awesome. So your name's going to be on the main menu now. Right on. Is a const in C++ the same like a final in Java? I don't know what a final in Java is. Yes, oh yeah, it's just not changeable, that's true. If that's what final means in Java, then yeah. Const just means you can't ever change this variable later. And essentially it's a kind of a replacement for pound define almost. What's up, Scale Fiddler? It's going great, man. I'm making this ice sword. I'm just gonna check it out now, run it again, and see how these particles look now with the ice on them. Yeah, it's looking better. I think I'd like to see a little more jitter as they fall too. And a little bit more of them too. What sound? Which one? When Jib scanned a dude? So let's go even long, like closer to together, and then a little more jitter here, and a little more jitter also in the X. So we'll go. Man, my phone is blowing up with text right now. Drand f times, oh, that's what it is. Sorry, yeah. Momir, that sound is my phone giving me text messages, so. Nice. Yes, Alien, I highly recommend Unity and Unreal. They're great ways to learn how to make games and get started on a project. The challenge you face right here is you kind of have two things you need to do. One, you need to get used to a game engine, and two, you need to get started on your game project. So just keep that in mind. If you're not familiar with the game engine already, it is going to take you time to get used to that. So just remember that, and that's what I'm saying. Don't get frustrated if it takes you time to learn how to do stuff in a game engine, because that's just how it works. It takes time to get used to stuff. You probably already know that, though. Yeah. The software uses specular and bump lighting on the pixels? No, it doesn't. I'd like to implement that, though. Do I have a dog? No, but I do love dogs. I would love to have a dog for sure at some point. Oh, sweet. Now they're looking a little better. Oh, what the heck? I think it did two particles per. Oh, that looks sweet. I don't know. That's a total accident. Haha, I love that. You know what? I think I know what it is. I think the actual delay between each particle is so small that the game engine actually put them exactly together. That's looking sweet. How does it look to the north, though? Oh, you see what happened? Oh, it froze an enemy that was already dead. That's what's going on. So let me confirm that. You're sitting next to a dog right now. Yeah, I'll try that too. But let me see if that's true. That if I kill an enemy and then hit him again with the ice sword, it like brings him back to life, sort of. So there's a dead enemy. No, I guess not. Yeah, see that? It totally brought him back to. Oh, okay, I know what it is. I render frozen. Yeah, here's where it unfreezes, and we want to make sure if. F dot health dot HP is less than or equal to zero. Just return from this method. So it's not going to actually make them thaw out if they're just dead. I think that's what was going on there. So okay, now I can go back to that other method and add in a little bit of random height. Height plus drand f times 2. That'll give it 2 pixels. Yeah. Yeah, Alien, I do have a long, long coding programmer background. So I started coding in 1994. And I immediately jumped into games. I did it because I wanted to make games. So I've actually been making games since 1994. My first one I released in 1995. And so I do have a lot of experience with programming. I did some programming where I was... yeah, that's looking way better. So I did some programming that was just business related and I hated it. And so I went back to making games in 2010. And yeah, and then I got used to the Cocos 2D game engine, and I wrote a few other games, and now I'm finally making this game. I learned a lot of lessons along the way, and I try and share those lessons as much as I can, because I want you guys to be able to make games faster than I can make them, you know what I mean? Or at least get to the point in your lives where you're able to make games how you truly want to. Yeah, this is looking sweet. Nice. VS Code has no garbage collection. If you get a dog, name him Gotham. I must leave Gotham needs me. That's a pretty good one. I'm not the owner Gotham needs. Yes, yeah, the last game I made is called Hero Bash, and it failed financially, but I think it's a pretty cool game. It's a MOBA for iOS, so it's a free game. That's basically why it failed financially, is it's a free game, and we didn't market it. So we thought that we could spend $5,000 after we all produced the whole game to create enough marketing to be successful. But I realized from making this game that you've got to share your game from day one. You really got to do your own marketing as an indie, because no one's going to do that marketing for you, not even $5,000, which is not really that much to spend on marketing, really. But to me, it was, to me and my friend. So does the duration stack? No, it does not currently. What are your thoughts on that? I'd love to get some thoughts on that. Right now, I make it so it's just, if you hit him once, it's like 5 seconds, which is quite a long time, right? And so it doesn't stack. Well, there you go. Yeah, if that's your love, that's great. You know? Business, I've met many people like this, too. It's like business truly is a love. And man, I'm excited for you. That's rad. Just to know what you love to do is a big thing right there. No, dude, my dad is You know how, like, your parents or whatever don't really know the texting etiquette or whatever? That's like my dad. He's not really that knowledgeable about etiquette. Yeah. It's cool, right? It's cool to show fans of the game, but it's also cool to inspire other people too, you know? Because when you share the process like this, other people, like, get in on it a little bit, and they can, you know. I'm just excited to be an inspiration and... So if I kill this guy, wait, let's see that again. If I kill that guy, he should not come back to life all of a sudden. Okay, that was fine. Oh, but it did blink him. So let's turn off the blink too. Frozen. Here, thawing out. Oh, you know what? It's kind of the thing that's like hard to disable. If it did stack, you could do a lower duration. That's a good thought. Yeah. they're all picture messages. He's like on some vacation and he just sends me like a billion messages. This is funny. Yes, right? Yeah, you ask people what they want to do and they don't know. It's cool. It's so cool to know what you want to do, for sure. Nice. After you, and see, Grimgary, you do kind of know. You know it involves programming, art, and games. So where's the thing where it blinks? It blinks them back to life. They thaw out. Ah, here it is. Yeah, okay, so all I would do is I can make this thaw out method a little bit smarter. So this will probably be the last thing I do today on the stream. I'm gonna make it so when they thaw out, the enemy is gonna check and see if it has hit points before it does the thaw out. So we're gonna go duration minus thaw duration, and this is thaw. Prepare design docs or rapid prototyping or hybrid. How about neither? I know that sounds crazy, but I don't believe in design docs at all. So I guess I would say rapid prototyping, yeah, all the way. Just create the game as fast as you possibly can. Or just create it in your mind first, man, and don't worry about making a design doc. But I guess in teams, it's different. It's a totally different question if you're in a team. So if you're in a team of developers, a design doc can help, or a rapid prototype, I guess, can help. But if you're a solo person making the game, I don't think it really matters that much. Baby!
Hi!
Just finishing up. Okay. We'll go celebrate. Yeah. It is. It kind of is like being... There's like a career path to being a game developer now. Yes. Yeah, Zatrick. Yeah, totally. Alien, you're right, man. I'm so glad you recognize this. Game devs, it's just getting... It's getting really awesome how many great tools we have these days. All right, Brunsbear, have fun, man. Have fun in the Baltic... Yeah. Oh, we're celebrating my girl just got a promotion. Baby, they're saying congratulations, by the way. See that? She says thank you. Yep. Okay, so we've already got the delay time for duration minus thaw. So really, we just need to do a blink action here. We don't need another sequence. And we can do ice color. Oh, we can capture ice color. And we need to use F. And we don't need a delay duration minus thaw duration. We just need to do thaw duration plus a third there. Oh, we need a thaw duration out here. And we need to capture thaw duration. Okay, let's see if all that works. Yes, true, right? I think that's what got me back into game development too. I'm like, man, the tools have gotten a lot better these days. Insidey, this is Xcode, man. It's just it's called an integrated development environment. It means that you can write code in it and it runs your code too and compiles your code and links your code. It does all that kind of stuff. It's called an IDE, Integrated Development Environment. Visual Studio's another one that's on Windows. That's a real popular one. And Xcode's really popular on Macs. Okay, so let's see how it's still got the particles coming off the back. And let's see what happens when we kill an enemy while they're frozen. Yeah, cool. Awesome, cool. So we can kill enemies now when they're frozen and they don't flash or de-thaw or play their idle animations. So, all right, that's it for today's stream, you guys. Yes. Oh, whoa, you've been a AAA game dev. Nice, man. Yeah, it definitely does, right? It totally makes, it's based on your team and size, totally. Some random troll from the internet says congrats. Nice one. Dude. How do you get good at code? Just keep doing it, man. And keep doing what you love. If you hate parts of it, don't do them. That's my advice. And I really, really mean that. Practice exactly. Yep. Oh, sorry, iPad user. Yeah, good night, you guys. Enjoy. I'll be back tomorrow. Tomorrow, same time. I'm usually about 4 p.m. Pacific, but you can follow me to get the exact time that I go online. It changes every day, basically. So, cheers, everybody. And I will definitely do my homework. I got tons of links on my desktop, and I hate having links on my desktop, so that's why I do my homework every night. Just look up Xcode. Yeah, there you go. You got it. Cool, you guys. Good night. Appreciate you all. Thanks for all the great ideas, and we'll see you next time.